I wanted to welcome everyone to this year's Global Studies Office of International Education Student Symposium. I'm excited that we can take a chance today to have a look at what global studies can teach us and listen to two exceptional papers from Dr. Bischoff's Global Studies Senior Seminar in the fall. So first we will hear from Mihir Kaur. Her paper is entitled A Case of Neoliberal Urban Development, Segregation and Social Exclusion in Gurgaon, India. And then we'll hear from Caroline Fernandez, whose paper is entitled Disney Goes Global, Missteps with Mulan.
So my name is Mihir. I'm a senior and I'm a global studies and econ arts and sciences double major. And I did my project this past fall with Professor Bischoff, which was a great class and a great experience. So I will share that with you now. So my project is here titled Profit Over People, a study of neoliberal urban development in Gurgaon, India. And it was really inspired by my study abroad in fall 2019, where I did a urban studies program in Buenos Aires, Barcelona, and Cape Town. And I did a comparative research project there looking at neoliberal development in the waterfronts of each city. So I decided to continue with some similar themes last semester with my research project. And I focused on India, which is a country very close to me and an issue I really care about. So this is my presentation. So Gurgaon is also known as Gurugram. It's a city in the northern state of Haryana in India. It was established in 1982, has a population of probably close to a million or over a million. I think this estimate is a little old. And it's known as the technology and business hub of India. It's very close to the capital of New Delhi. It's an up-and-coming city. Not so great place, actually. So why did I decide to focus on this city for an entire semester and write a 30-page paper on it? It's actually a very interesting city. So the inside of Gurgaon looks like this. It's known as a millennium city, which is this concept in India that's like a smart city. There's a lot of huge multinational firms in Gurgaon, like Google, HSBC, Nokia, and therefore you see a lot of well-educated professional employees coming to Gurgaon for these great Western jobs. It's also a city that's nearly entirely privately developed. So you don't really see much of the public sector or a public presence there. So this picture here is a typical privately developed gated community in Gurgaon, which it's basically gated. You would go through the gates and inside you have literally everything you could need. So like luxury five-star hotel vibes type of living situation. You have shopping malls, you have swimming pools, golf courses, and also things that typically the public sector would provide. So healthcare, you have your own police and fire station, daycare, schools for your children. Everything is inside this gated community. So Gurgaon is really a place where young hip people wanna go for once they get educated, you wanna move to Gurgaon, you wanna get a job there, a place to live there. But there's also another side of the city. So if you look, if you stand outside of these gated communities and look on the city, you see really a social failure. You see a lack of sewage, a lack of groundwater management. There's massive traffic jams because the city is not well planned at all. There's constant water shortages, potholes. And also while the city has a lot of the elite that are attracted to these multinational corporations, there's also a lot of blue collar workers. So people from the working class that come to work in the restaurants or work in the hotels that serve the elite. And because you have these gated communities, you have bubbles, like little pockets of people where certain people are allowed in some spaces and certain people are not allowed in others. And this has recently caught the eye of the public. There's been a lot of more artistic journalism and also informative journalism on Gurgaon and why it looks the way that it does. And also I want to point out that it's not completely unique. Like there's a lot of smart cities and millennium cities in India and a lot of them face a lot of problems that are similar to this. So my research focused on two main questions. Firstly, how has Gurgaon's private development impacted the way it is lived today? And secondly, how is Gurgaon a product of and a contributor to India's transition towards a capitalistic and neoliberal phase of globalization. So my argument that I make through my paper is that the inequity visible in Gurgaon is a direct result of profit-driven private development fueled by a neoliberal Indian state attempting to achieve Western ideals of modernity. So this is a little complex, a lot of different theoretical moving parts, but to try to break it down, something I really focus on throughout my paper is this idea of neoliberalism and neoliberal development. So I have a kind of more technical definition here. It's basically characterized by open, competitive, and unregulated markets and kind of decentralization of government. This concept of flagship developments plays a really important role in neoliberalism. So for example, a flagship development would be something like a luxury gated community in Gurgaon, because the objective of this flagship development is not to provide housing and shelter for people as a human need, but it's rather to generate profit and to work with this ideal of a modern Indian state that Gurgaon is trying to achieve. So that's kind of my theoretical framework. And how I make this argument is, first, I look at the history of Gurgaon and how it is developed in tangent with India's neoliberal shift. And then I look at some other smaller pockets of evidence. But first, let's take a look at the history. So India became independent in 1947. Right off the bat, it adopted a socialist and anti-consumerist approach to development. And unfortunately, in the 1960s and 1970s, it faced a decline in economic growth, which obviously prompted maybe a shift away from some of the socialist policies. At the same time that this was happening, a private developer known as DLF secured land for private development in Gurgaon. And this is important due to the context and the way in which this land was acquired. So at the time of socialist policies in India, Gurgaon was specifically declared as an agricultural wasteland. Like, they were trying to roll out some agricultural policies and the land there was not like workable for agriculture and farming. So nothing was developed there at all. It had no form of government. And at the time when DLF was looking for land to secure, land in Delhi, the capital, was very tightly controlled due to the socialist policies. And therefore, they turned to Gurgaon and started to look to develop it privately. So right from the beginning, Gurgaon was a very exclusive pocket of land that was very different from other pockets of land that were still very tightly controlled. So at the same time that Gurgaon was beginning to be developed in the 1980s and 1990s, in the 1990s, India officially was integrated into the global economy. So it liberalized due to some IMF loans, had to open up its economy. And this kind of fostered in an era of globalization and neoliberal growth. And in this context, cities play a very big role for capital accumulation. So a lot of capital and investment is being pushed into cities. And Gurgaon, which is already known as like this private development haven, is going to start playing a very big role. So here, this is kind of a lot of information, but the point of all these bullets was to show that the policies that were enacted were reflective of neoliberal policy changes. So in the state of Haryana, where Gurgaon is specifically, you see a lot of priority being given to private developers. So you see private growth of the housing market, you see special economic zone policies where any company related to the IT sector is given priority, which is why you see companies like Nokia and Google there now, and very uneven public and private development. So like I said, because Gurgaon was an agricultural wasteland, they didn't really have a municipal government there. And then all of a sudden, you see like rapid urbanization, and a lot of it is privately done. So you have these private bubbles of things like police and security and water and wastewater management. But at the same time, the public sector is basically doing absolutely nothing. So that's kind of the history, how it went down. And today, because of that, Gurgaon is a city of massive inequality. So at the top, you see the private gated communities. And at the bottom picture, you see the failure of public infrastructure. It's like Gurgaon is infamous for its flooding that occurs whenever there's like the monsoon seasons, just because the city is not well planned and nothing was laid out according to how it was meant to be. So the evidence I looked at in my paper is first private developers' websites, and then I also looked at news media coverage and official government documents. And the goal of this evidence was to look at what the intention was behind urbanization in Gurgaon and how it is marketed to the public. What is the public perception of it? So firstly, looking at private developers' websites, it's very interesting because I did a lot of reading about urbanism and gated communities, and a lot of the theory, like the sociological theory, is directly reflected in the language of the websites. It's kind of creepy, actually. So a lot of the readings talked about how enclosed gated communities are kind of rested on three main concepts of lifestyle, prestige, and security. So if you're in a gated community, you're being marketed not just housing, like it's not just an apartment where you will live, like a place of shelter, you're being marketed a lifestyle. So it's a lifestyle of luxury, a lifestyle of prestige. It's a place that is secure and different from the rest of India. And you really see this in the words on the website. So this is from DLF, that first big company that began development in Gurgaon. And it literally says the ultimate lifestyle, one with the elements. So it calls itself a flagship project. It talks about how it has schools, office spaces, cutting edge luxury complexes. It's a way of life. And the idea behind this is that certain people are going to be able to access these private developments and certain people are not. So a lot of the working class that comes to Gurgaon, of course, is not going to be able to afford something like a DLF luxury apartment in a gated community, whereas people who come who are well-educated, the elite of India, will. And what results is these bubbles and like extreme social exclusion and segregation. The second evidence I looked at was official government documents. So I looked at a land planning document from 1980, I believe. I'm forgetting the dates. And then there were the minutes of a meeting in a municipal meeting in Gurgaon from 1990. And these reflect two main things. So first, you see the neoliberal policies coming through. So relaxation of land use, you see like this idea of modernity and pressures of national capital. So you see how the neoliberalism of the time is reflected in the policies. And at the same time, you see local governments in Gurgaon and Haryana kind of struggling to provide public services. So in the meeting minutes, for example, you see them debating over like which government organization or which government sector is going to be in charge of this or who's going to be in charge of that. There's a lot of negotiation. You can tell it's not really very well planned out. And something I found particularly interesting was that they decided to have these pockets. They literally called it pockets. And they called private developers colonizers. And they decided to tell the colonizers that they should be providing public services such as sewage and police. And the idea sounds great in theory. Like, if you are a private developer, you shouldn't be coming in and just building a luxury apartment, you should also be providing other things. But what resulted was even more extreme bubbles, where people in that bubble get access to like world-class healthcare and sewage, but everyone outside doesn't. So you just see the government being unable to manage this massive urbanization that is the result of neoliberal policy. And lastly, I looked at news media coverage. So I analyzed sources from two main news sites. And it's important to note that they were in English because I can't read in Hindi. So they are catering to more of like an English speaking crowd in India, which of course is an influence. But a lot of the news media coverage focused on celebrities, business, and the housing market. So you also see like Gurgaon is a poppin city. So you see a lot of mention of celebrities and like luxury apartments. Oh, this mall opened with this designer brand. But at the same time, you see a lot of talk about like COVID failures and the inability of the public sector to manage COVID while the private communities are all like perfectly well staffed. Or there's a lot of talk about flooding during monsoon season, residents being unhappy. And that's all reflected in the media. And even more so nowadays, given the crisis of COVID. So in conclusion, you can really see the consequences of capital and profit-driven development, which results from the neoliberal policy. that kind of led to the development of Gurgaon. It's, in theory, neoliberal policy is supposed to liberalize the economy, bring in lots of growth and capital accumulation, but it's always important to ask, who is that for? It's rarely ever for the people like who make up the working class, which is the huge majority in India. Those people are never going to be able to afford the luxury communities in Gurgaon. And because Gurgaon is so privately developed, almost exclusively privately developed, it's an interesting way that the lived experiences play out in a city like that. And I think this conversation is especially important because you see a lot of these cities continuing to be built in India. A smart city is like an official like government plan in India where they're rolling out these cities across India, and they're great in theory, but environmentally and socially, they're an absolute disaster. And now even more, you see with the farmers' protests in India, more effects of neoliberal policy where farmers from all around the country are protesting these laws that completely will destroy their livelihoods. So again, just to reiterate, it's always important to examine neoliberal policies that play out in the developing world because they oftentimes do not help the working class and result in extreme social and exclusion and segregation. Thank you.
Great, thank you. Yeah, virtual clapping, not as exciting as in-person clapping. Thank you for that great presentation. And I wanted to open it up now for questions. And I will say my Global Studies 400 senior seminar students are joining us here. And so I encourage questions from everyone about the content of the presentation, but also for my students, questions about the research process, how you found primary sources, those kinds of things I strongly encourage as well. So I wanted to open it up. Jack, I see your hand up.
Yeah, so on the research methods, I thought that the, like you finding the minutes for a governmental meeting was really interesting. How did you decide to look for that and how did you find that and sources similar to that?
Yeah, that's a good question. I actually really struggled with finding official government documentation, especially in India. It's not really well recorded and like administratively kept track of. Professor Bishop actually helped me with that. We found a couple websites from Gurgaon specifically, and then also from Haryana at large that had land planning documents. And they were very bureaucratic. So I kind of just had to shift through and see in terms of the dates that I was looking for, what applied to my research project, and then also what I could actually understand, to be honest. Like a lot of it was just administrative or urban things that were completely over my head. But yeah, that was definitely a challenge locating those documents.
Dean Merritt.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. I could hear the whole presentation. I just couldn't join you. So it's lovely to be here. Meher, I really appreciate such a well-researched city-level study. Cities are such great texts. I wondered, as a Russianist, if you could witness in the development of, or the sort of triumph of neoliberalism in this location, some of the tugging between socialism, which is, as you rightly noted, part of India's developmental path, and the sort of solution to socialism, which swung way too far in the other direction. Were there corrective measures? Was there debate?
I don't think I saw any in my research. I mean, it's not completely black and white. So in a lot of the government documents, you don't see the government like trying to completely destroy the city or anything like that. Like they're not completely trying to hand it over to private developers. They do have the social good of the populace in mind. So it's not like a completely black and white picture. But at the same time, you don't really see that debate in the documents or that conversation about like what's happening and why it's happening.
Adelaide.
Did you have any trouble finding sources in English? Or was there a pretty wide variety of like primary and secondary sources in a language that you could understand?
That's a good question. So like I mentioned, for the news media sources, I would have liked to find something in Hindi, which would have been better because most of the local community in India speaks Hindi. So that would be a more local source. But I didn't find a problem finding things in English. I think also just the nature of the topic itself. I didn't really expect to find like a private developer's website in Hindi because like they aren't really catering to that pocket of the population that only speaks Hindi. They're really catering to the educated people who speak English. So I think that was also, just given the nature of my topic and what I was looking for, that wasn't a huge problem.
Manya.
Thanks for the presentation. Firstly, it was really great. My question sounds a bit long, but I'm gonna try to find words. I think you mentioned that even though this city is catered toward the rich people, it still has lots of jobs created for blue collar workers as they work in the restaurants or as they work in the other areas that, for the rich. And I guess since this is privately developed, this DLF is the one that creates these jobs technically, no matter what the results of inequality and social exclusions are. I'm wondering if you saw any evidence that, let's say, this private enterprise didn't exist, would government be willing to sort of implement a similar or even like a different project that would employ as many people from like the blue collar field, I guess, or just the poor people in general?
That's a good question. I mean, you're right, like that definitely is one aspect of it. Like you do see these jobs being created. The government does have a bunch of schemes, like, or like I guess welfare plans, to employ people from the working class. So for example, there's one particular scheme called the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, where the government hires people. They're basically guaranteed employment for public sector projects. And that's in contrast to something like, for example, DLF right now is building its own private highway in Gurgaon, where like you have to pay a toll and it's like completely privately built. But at the same time, something like that could be built by the government, and the jobs from that also could be given to rural workers through this Rural Employment Guarantee Act. So there definitely are instances of governments trying to create jobs, but at the same time, I do see that like private development like this does generate quite a few jobs for the working class as well.
Valentina.
Yeah, thank you so much for your presentation. I had a question kind of similar to Manya's, but mine was more about almost housing for poor individuals in these communities and just what kind of housing is available to them. Like, is it similarly private sector housing, but just to like a lesser quality, or is there some kind of like public, like government involvement in providing affordable housing for these individuals?
Yeah, that's a good question too. So there is some like public housing, but a lot of it is informal settlements. So you see a lot of slums like on the periphery of Gurgaon. And then you also see a lot of migrant workers. So people who like come for day work or work on like a contract basis. But yeah, most of the private development isn't really for a lot of the working class at all.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you, Mihir. And so our second student presenter, as I said, will be Caroline Fernandez, who is presenting a paper entitled Disney Goes Global, Missteps with Mulan.
Great. So like Dr. Prabal said, my presentation is about Mulan 2020, which is the live action remake of the 1998 version of Mulan by Disney, which is itself an adaptation of the centuries-old Chinese folklore folktale, The Ballad of Mulan. So in this presentation, essentially, I was just very curious about sort of what the process was for making this Mulan adaptation and what some of the snags were that Disney ran into, what it might have been thinking about during this time while it was trying to market this story to two very different audiences, to both the Chinese audience and the US or more broadly Western audience. So here's some questions that I would recommend keeping in mind, because they were definitely questions that I had when I was, you know, doing my research first, was what were Disney's priorities during the making of the film and release? And then what were the American and Chinese responses to the film? Underlying these questions is this idea of both political and cultural navigation that was needed during this production of sort of a film that was going to span two very different cultures. For this presentation and the research project in general, I focused mostly on news coverage or sources sourced from news media, both in terms of interviews and sort of like first person contact with people involved in the film itself, and then also in terms of the reaction from the public represented by the news media to the film after it was released. And then one underlying question that we'll also revisit at the end is this question of whether a global corporation can be non-political if it's trying to be non-political, and whether that can be achieved and what some of the problems they might have to face are. So to begin, we'll have one section just sort of dedicated to giving you guys a little bit of background and context about sort of what Disney might have had in mind when it was making Mulan 2020. First is this idea of the culture of Disney. So we'll actually see Nikki Caro, the director of Mulan, refer to this phrase later. And so I wanted to like sort of dissect what is the culture of Disney. Interestingly, I think it's changed quite a bit. So in 1955, in this quote from Walt Disney during his dedication speech for Disneyland, you can see there's this emphasis on America, the US. So this idea of the American dream, American ideals and values that certainly might be exported, but that are centered in the United States. But that's really evolved. This screenshot with our mission is from fall 2020 from the Disney page. And you can see the emphasis there is on this globalism and on this idea that the Disney company is this universal company, not confined to one country. So there's this really big emphasis on universal stories and values. And I think in Mulan, Disney was really trying to find a way to tell a universal story. And we'll see that the production crew really thought of that as a female empowerment story and thought that that would have the universal appeal they were looking for. And of course, with the Disney princesses, it's nothing too out of the ordinary for Disney that there has been this sort of line of female characters. Another important piece of background that you guys should know are these two films, so Kundun and Mulan, the animated version. So of course, the animated version we've discussed, but Kundun, a lot of you guys probably have never heard of. I had not heard about it either, because for good reason, because Kundun was produced in 1997, 1 year before the animated Mulan was released, and it was about the 14th Dalai Lama. The 14th Dalai Lama is very controversial in Chinese culture. The Chinese government, the Communist Party of China, or the CCP, has termed the Dalai Lama a splittist. So essentially, he's what they see as a figure for the movement for Tibetan independence from China. So it's very controversial. And when this film was being produced, China was really unhappy about it. And not only was the film banned from being released in China, but Disney as a company was basically blacklisted after its release. Martin Scorsese, who directed the film, is on radio having said that he thought Disney played down the film in response to the Chinese response. So even outside of China, it was really sort of swept under the rug. This was especially problematic because China has a lot of control over what films are released in the country, the government does. So they actually only opened up to foreign films in 1994. And even then, there was a cap on only 10 foreign films to be released in the country each year. Now the cap is 34. So it was very difficult to get a foothold into the country, and the loss of that foothold for Disney would have been pretty disastrous. And so the animated Mulan was seen as sort of like a way for Disney to regain its position in China. And fortunately for them, they were able to release the film. So that was in some ways a victory, but at the same time, not a resounding one, because the Chinese audience had a sort of a lukewarm response to the film, not because of, you know, political issues, but because of this cultural idea that they saw the film as being westernized and not being super culturally accurate. And this would sort of foreshadow some issues that would confront Mulan 2020. So of course the question is, why is China so important to Disney? And simply put, it's because of money. China has a really big market right now. Back in 1997 with Kundun, it was much smaller, but there was still that potential for great box office returns. And also, it's not just the films. Disney is sort of like a bigger brand than just the films. There's merchandise, there's theme parks. Right now they have some in Hong Kong and Shanghai. So this sort of Disney lifestyle, Disney brand is something that they really wanted to have access in China for. And then moving on, because of that great carrot of the Chinese, you know, populace and the money that they're willing to spend, China also has a lot of leverage, and studios are willing to kind of comply with Chinese regulations so that they can get access to that market. There was a recent report released in 2020, I think in August, so quite recent, and it was about just sort of how much Hollywood studios will cater to Chinese demands in order to have their films released. And this report essentially said that these studios will self-censor ahead of time before they even have to turn in their films to be screened by the CCP, which every film has to be done, has to be screened. But even before that, they'll work with Chinese officials to ensure that they won't have any problems when they submit the film for screening. So this idea of having pretty strict requirements, so the language is quite broad, but essentially anything that might be questionable for like national security, ethnic issues, things like that, China sort of reserves the right to censor films for. So these are all things that Disney would have had in mind when producing Mulan. And now we're going to quickly walk through the sort of three phases of the film development, production and filming, and then the release, and see just some of the practical applications of these broader pictures. So in development, I want to talk about two things. First, the casting, or first the crew, and then the cast. So here you can see some pictures of the people who were behind the film. These are the director, Nikki Kaur, on the top, and then the screenwriters on the two bottom pictures. And you can see some quotes from them. This really underlines how this push towards the universal female empowerment story that the production crew had in mind. And just this idea of wanting to make a universally appealing story and seeing the idea of Mulan as this like feminist hero as something that would be the great like connector for the film. Interestingly, you will note that all of the pictures here are of white people and mostly Americans. Nikki Kaur is from New Zealand. And so most of the production crew of Mulan was not Asian or of Chinese descent, which I won't say, and I don't speculate in the paper, I wouldn't say that's directly the reason for some of the cultural issues that would arise later, but perhaps did allow for the oversight of those issues that wouldn't have set off any red flags that might have otherwise been seen with a more diverse production crew. When it comes to the cast was majority Chinese. You can see some of the characters here, or the cast here in their costumes. And noticeably, many of these characters were very well-known Chinese actors, are very well-known Chinese actors. Yu Yifei, who is the actress for Mulan, is very well-known in China. And so this was definitely a bid by Disney to have that sort of name brand recognition in China, and shows how important the Chinese market was for the company. There was some controversy about casting and about the script in the earlier years of the development, which was resolved. And as we can see, a majority Chinese cast was cast. But again, noticeably, one of the, in this open letter, a petition that responded to that open letter asked for an Asian American screenwriter to be added to the team, which did not happen. And so again, preserved the majority white production crew of the film. So moving on to production and filming, I want to speak about one incident in particular. This was Yu Yifei's post about the Hong Kong police in August 2019. So this is when the hashtag boycott Mulan first trended on Twitter. Yu Yifei reposted a post by a Chinese newspaper, People's Daily, essentially saying that she supported the Hong Kong police and quoting a Chinese journalist who had been attacked by Hong Kong protesters the day before, and essentially supporting that situation, or the journalist. And this was very controversial because in Western media and in Western eyes, these protests are pro-democratic alternatively, they could be pronounced anti-government, so whichever one. But these are protests by Hong Kong activists against increased mainland Chinese government influence in Hong Kong, which has historically been pretty autonomous. And so Western media and Hong Kong activists were very upset about this and accused Disney and Yui Fei of being anti-democratic and whatnot. And this was the first sort of controversy between these two different political ideologies and politics games in these two different countries. Disney responded by trying to keep it non-political. So keep that in mind. Then the second controversy, which happened in September 2020 after the film was released, was controversy over filming in Xinjiang, which is an area in China where the Chinese government has been accused by Western media of setting up concentration or internment camps for a Muslim minority population in the area. It's this orange area here, the Uyghur population. China terms these re-education camps or job centers, job training centers. So that's just that context as well. But essentially, in the credits of Mulan, the film thanked some government entities in the region in Xinjiang. And so this was like a major controversy as well in Western media. And essentially people saw this as Disney compromising sort of ethical boundaries, crossing those ethical lines to comply with the CCP. As you can see, this really dominated the American response. So politicians called for Disney to explain themselves, Amnesty International asked for a human rights report, and then the media really just concentrated on these ethical controversies rather than the content of the film itself after the film was released. So I surveyed the New York Times, Washington Post, Wall Street Journal, and Reuters coverage in September of the film, and it was mostly focused on these negative human rights and ethical controversies. In contrast, in the Chinese response, the response wasn't positive either, not very much, but interestingly, it focused on different problems of the film. Here, instead of focusing on the ethical controversies, it talked about the cultural inauthenticity of the film. And again, sort of a callback to Mulan 1998, where the viewers didn't feel that the film was appropriately Chinese or appropriately culturally accurate or authentic. One thing that I thought was really interesting was this op-ed in China Daily about like feminism in Mulan and how it was more in line with sort of the Western audience. And there was this one particular scene in the film where Mulan like takes off her armor and takes down her hair and is, this is supposed to be like the point where she's revealing herself as a woman to the army. And the costume director of Mulan had noted that this was like a major turning point in the film and had been very carefully crafted. But Chinese audiences reacted to this in some reviews online as being going against some Chinese cultural values, especially of the idea of filial piety or loyalty to family, because the armor was Mulan's father's and throwing it away would have been like a highly unfilial act. So just this idea of this cultural mistranslation that once again just led to some problems for Disney. Okay. To conclude things, I know we might be a minute or two over time. So sort of my biggest takeaways from this research project was that Disney really emphasized accessing the Chinese market and learn from their issues with Kunlun. And so really tried to comply with the CCP, but maybe didn't expect how many problems this would cause for their relationship with the American market. By not condemning ethical issues, by filming in Xinjiang, et cetera, the American market proved unable to sort of overlook those controversies. And then at the same time, they under-prioritized appealing to the Chinese market with these cultural issues that came up that proved to just be unappealing to the Chinese market that they had tried so hard to access. And then finally, I just wanna bring your thoughts back to this final question of, can a global corporation be non-political? So, I don't think that the research I have done can be, you know, broadly assumed to be like the truth on whether a global corporation can be non-political, but I do think it's a good case study of many of the issues that these many companies who are trying to go global will face when they try to do so. Yeah. Okay. And then that's my conclusion there. And I'm happy to take any questions about either the content or just the process of doing this research project. Thanks for listening.
Thank you, Carolyn. So I will open it up for questions from our audience, and we're all. I see Dean Merritt's
here. I just want to show off that I'm really here and my microphone works now. Another great international presentation. Thank you so much. Do you have any sense that both this controversy and movements that were already underway have led to what the New York Times anyway is busy writing about for the last 2 months, a sort of renaissance in films that have more legitimate claim to authenticity, that are from China, about China, or feature actors and actresses who have some stake in the content of the work? I mean, I don't know if your interest, Caroline, is in film and you brought it to Mulan, or if you're interested in stereotyping and you went to film, but it seems like there is a movement that may have in part been informed by the story you tell.
Yeah, yeah, certainly. I think one of the original reasons why I thought about Mulan, and I had originally thought about doing more of a broader survey of like Chinese and Asian American representation in film in recent years, because it has really, I think, grown, especially in Hollywood. I'm not super familiar with Chinese produced films, so I can't comment too much there. And there have been a lot of successes in terms of, you know, Asian directed films starring Asian casts. For example, like The Farewell was a really great one recently. So yes, I think I saw it more as a film by a much bigger studio than a lot of these other films that was coming at the same time as this increase in Asian and Asian American representation in cinema. So it was seen as something that I think if it had succeeded could have pulled that more into the mainstream. I don't think a lot of people would have said it was a full success. So I don't think it really succeeded in doing that. But I do think it perhaps continued to propel the conversation that was sort of already happening around Asian American representation in film. Yeah, so sort of next to it, but perhaps not fully contributing to it due to sort of the outcome of that film. Yeah.
Great. Noah, I saw your hand up.
As someone who's like been following the Uyghur crisis pretty closely, I remember when Mulan came out, like that was like the biggest deal. And it was really interesting to hear about the other factors regarding like Hong Kong and the cultural disparities. How did you kind of come up with the scope of determining like which of these factors had perhaps the most influence or contributed to Mulan's ultimate like boycott?
Yeah. Sure. I think a lot of it was just like sort of retracing the history. So I had casually followed this, but hadn't really dived deep into the coverage of it. And I think after just like reading a lot of articles by all these different sites, you can sort of get a sense for what caused the most attention and what was mentioned the most, especially like post-release. And of course, this is a project that was conducted pretty soon after the release of the film, so very much in the moment. And I think it'll be interesting to see, you know, in like 2 years, like what articles are referring to and what scholarship might be seeing from a sort of like in hindsight bird's eye lens. But I think I just based it off of the sheer amount of coverage and the extent to like which articles and authors really dove into certain areas. So especially for Xinjiang and the Hong Kong protests, there was some coverage, even like statistically covering the prevalence of Boycott Mulan on Twitter and like how many people tweeted and like what those tweets, whether they expressed negative sentiment and things like that. So that also helps that there was a slight amount of quantitative data that I could sort of rely on to be like, oh, this was a really big event within this film's production. Yeah.
Thank you.
I was just curious about your research question forming process, your research idea process. And you kind of touched on this when you were answering Dean Merritt's question, but like, where did you start? Did you start first with your question about whether global corporations can be apolitical, or did you focus first on Mulan or focus first on films? I'm just kind of curious to see your whole process there.
Yeah, definitely. Well, Dr. Bischoff can tell you it was quite complicated. It was not something where I came in being like, I'm going to research Mulan, and this is like, I really know where I'm going. I actually had a different topic in mind, and I'm trying to remember what it was. It was nothing related to film. It was like about international education, maybe, things like that. So very different. But I just was very curious, you know, Mulan was making a lot of headlines around this time. And I have been, you know, casually interested in Asian American representation in cinema, and so thought that there might be something there. So initially I was thinking like maybe a couple of films. But then when I started reading more about Mulan, I just felt that there was a wealth of information already there. And Dr. Bischoff was, you know, hammering into us, narrow down your topic, you know, don't try to tackle the entire field. So I felt that there was enough information in Mulan for me to really get something out of it. In terms of the sort of overall takeaways, thesis, and questions, no, I wouldn't say that I knew what I was exactly going for when I started the research into Mulan. I definitely knew that there was some sense of navigating this American, United States, American audience divide. So I think that was what initially prompted sort of, or directed my research. And I did know that I wanted to survey Chinese English language media and American English language media and see like sort of the differences. So I started there. And I think that was enough of a foothold to go off of. But my bigger conclusions about like prioritizing access versus appeal, things like that came a little bit later. I think once I had sort of figured out what was even out there factually in the data and in the articles and things like that.
Yeah. That was really interesting. And I just kind of wondered, like, in your study of like Disney as a corporation itself and like other bigger corporations, do you think that moving forward, if they continue to try almost like globalize, I know that Pixar's coming out with a lot of different movies about a lot of different countries too. Like they're doing one on Colombia, which like I'm thrilled for, but like I do understand the fear of it being culturally inaccurate. So how do you think Disney is going to continue to like maneuver and like other big corporations can just like maneuver into almost like their globalization of the film market, and whether or not like you think that they perceive Mulan as a failure, or like are they going to take like lessons out of this, or
yes, definitely. Like I think that's a question that I continue to have, and this idea of like how much impact did this really have on Disney and their strategy. I thought something that was really interesting that I came across in my research, I did some reading into like scholarship of authenticity and this idea of like authentic branding and marketing, which was really interesting. I never read very much about it before. But this idea of the debate between whether a global brand and global can have like one global idea, or if it should have like culturally adapted, like more like culture specific versions. So I thought that was interesting and maybe pointed towards as a positive for having more specific presentations, so more specific films or more culturally specific products. And I wonder if that would be more successful in the sort of local market of that culture. Of course, though, there is still this balance between appealing to people who aren't from that culture or having some sort of, again, like universal appeal for those products. So I think I tend to advocate for like compromises and moderacy. So I think any company will have to figure out how to balance those things. I think Disney with Mulan in particular maybe went too far in the direction of just universal appeal rather than specifying to, you know, the source material. So maybe we'll see if in the future they take some lessons from that. But not sure, but we'll see. I'm really curious as well to see kind of what lessons are taken away from the film.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for the question.
Dr. Salisbury.
Hey, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Okay, fantastic. I'm calling from being in transit. First of all, I just want to congratulate both the presenters. Absolutely fantastic. Loved Mihara's presentation. And this one, Caroline, was really on point, because this morning in 290, we were talking about Said's Orientalism and imaginative geographies and McAllister's moral geographies. And I just love, for the sake of a few of the students who might be attending from 290, if you could speak to a little bit about how this sort of work breaks up that East-West binary that Said was presenting in his Orientalism and imaginative geographies writings.
Definitely. I guess in some senses, I think it transcends that. And in some senses, I think, unfortunately, can confirm some or like more affirm some things about just these stereotypes and what people have in mind when they think about East-West cultures and the differences therein. But yeah, I think generally like Asian American cinema and Mulan at their best can really create accessibility and reduce sort of like these sort of mental barriers and scholarly barriers that we have between like the East and West side of things, I guess, that are talked about in scholarship like Said and whatnot. And so I think making that accessible can be really awesome as well. One thing that I thought was really interesting about this research project was its focus on more like popular culture and popular entertainment, which is more accessible than a lot of scholarship. But at the same time, poorly done, I think these projects can have potential danger to reinforce this idea of like different cultures and this idea of the other. So yeah, I guess it's a balance, but certainly can, bringing these things into mainstream can be quite positive, productive.
I want to thank our student presenters for your excellent presentations, but also all the work you put into doing the research. Teaching the senior seminar, I know, as Dr. Bischoff wrote, it's often a winding journey, but the more it winds, the more interesting the final destination, as he said. I want to thank Dr. Bischoff for advising your work. I know that also on the part of the professor, that takes a deep investment, and I'm thankful to him for the work he did with both of you and the whole group. Thank you to Nancy Prost and to Michael for helping coordinate this event and organize this event. Global Studies is very grateful. And I think this was a great chance for us to see Global Studies at play. So the exciting thing about both these papers is that they engage these questions through different analytic lenses. And that's really the strength that we develop as Global Studies majors over the course of our time here, is the ability to look at a question and think about it through a policy lens and through a historical lens, as Meher did, or through kind of an identity-based lens and a media studies lens, as Carolyn did. And it really teaches us something completely new that if we're stuck in one discipline, we don't often see. So thanks to both of you for exhibiting that so well, and to all of you who attended. And I will now hand it off to Dean Merritt to close us out here.
Thank you, Dr. Pribble. One of the liabilities of speaking after you is you've stolen all my thunder of Global Studies, but I can do something you can't do, which is thank you for having taken on the coordination of Global Studies. I see the great work that preceded you being built upon as a foundation, and I'm really optimistic that next year, as Dr. Pribble knows, there can be exciting intersections between Global Studies and international education for a generation of students who didn't have the international engagement that we wish for all University of Richmond students. We'll do what we can to make up for that. But for today's presenters and those who asked questions and those who attended, Global Studies to me is such a beautiful intersection of the hard questions that cannot often be answered well within a single discipline. Stereotypical thinking, what does neoliberalism mean in application? Where is the correction for neoliberalism? Both of the fascinating papers today touched on colonialism, structures of who has the power here to represent, and led to lots of interesting questions that I'm still chewing on, which is always the sign of a worthy research project. I'm especially glad to see people doing really deep, well-informed case studies. I think at the undergraduate level, the sophistication of these questions playing out in a single space with all those intersecting tendrils can sometimes lead to amazing projects at the graduate level of comparing a city in India with Sao Paulo in Brazil, also a manufactured city that has tended to attract upper middle class and foreigners, and the film Mulan compared to, I can never remember the title of what I thought was that incredibly sappy, stereotypically written Latinx film. I always want to say Corazon or something, but anyway.
Coco.
So everyone seemed to love it, you know, so why did Coco work? Whereas I thought it was incredibly triacly. And this film tripped up in such fundamentally large ways. But those bigger comparisons come out of these incredibly deep and, as I said, sophisticated case studies. And it's been a real pleasure. So thanks to all of you for reinforcing why studies as a phenomenon, whether it's feminist studies or global studies or other forms of studies that are interdisciplinary, are so absolutely foundational to what we do at the University of Richmond. Thank you.